my personal views and opinions of the Donald Sterling and V. Stiviano controversy are as follows in this video. First off, when I first heard the comments of former Los Angeles Clippers owner Donald Sterling, which were provided by TMZ. TMZ is the celebrity gossip type magazine, e-magazine, if you will. You guys know the type. Those comments via a recording was provided by TMZ. I do not remember the website that I listened to the TMZ provided private recording between Sterling and V. Stiviano. However, I knew while listening to it and after listening to it, I knew it was an authentic tape. I knew that. I'm here in Los Angeles and I know all about Donald Sterling and his racist views and also actions here in Los Angeles. Donald was involved in this racial discrimination case against quote unquote minorities in a apartment. I believe it was like a major apartment complex racial discrimination suit brought against him by tenants whom he evidently discriminated against. And they were minorities, so-called minorities, Latinos and African Americans. So it was no shocker to myself, like many other people who know about the history of Donald Sterling. Sterling was also involved in a racial discrimination case against former Los Angeles Lakers great Elgin Baylor, who served as the general manager. I believe he was the general manager for the Los Angeles Clippers for a number of years. And I remember following his case against Donald Sterling and the Clippers. It too dealt with racial discrimination. So Sterling has that pattern. If you know Sterling or know about Sterling, he has that pattern. So when those comments came out, provided by TMZ, it wasn't a shocker to me. Donald Sterling. This time around, he really hung himself because his words were recorded. How Donald Sterling really is in real life was made public by V. Stiviano. And she had a MO. She had her reasons. And I'll get to that later on. Donald Sterling's comments to me had a lot of truth. He spoke a lot of truth. Yeah, the words were very racist. Some were very incendiary. But nevertheless, they were that man's true and real sentiments. And like them or not, you have to respect that. You have to respect that man's views. You don't have to agree with them, but you have to respect them in the sense that he has a right to have his views, just like I have a right to have my views that many of you may not agree with. But you have to respect the fact that I have my views. You have to respect the fact that others have their views, and you're not going to agree with those views. But we have to respect the fact that as humans, as people, we hold our own views, right or wrong, which are really irrelevant because it all boils down to perception. It boils down to perception. So the comments didn't offend me at all. I'm just that type of person. Plus, you know, I'm above the mundane. I don't trip on the mundane. know, I understand the lessons that the mundane serve us. I guess I should say I don't trip that much on the mundane because, you know, I am in the mundane realm in a mundane suit. So it's not that I'm 100% unperturbed by the mundane, but for the most part, I don't trip on mundane things. Okay, I don't want anybody to think that I'm immune to what takes place on the mundane because I'm in flesh. And like you, I'm still working on myself. See, what people have to understand about Donald Sterling, and of course I'm not an apologist for Donald Sterling. I'm here to give you some insight into that man, into that situation, into a certain mindset that does exist. And Donald Sterling helped us to know and also remember that a particular type of mindset does exist. So you got to give him some credit in a very strange way. Because he brought some things out. You know, some people got deluded by the inauguration of Barack Obama. Black man as president of a corporate United States of America. A lot of people got deluded. Progress. Things have changed in some areas. But in some areas, they have not. And they will not. And you better get used to it. Donald Sterling was raised a certain way. It's who he is. I am who I am because I was raised a certain way. And also I have made choices to view things, to view life a certain way. We all have. Pursuant to free will. And we're not going to all agree with the choices that each other has made. We're not going to agree with the choices to perceive life a certain way. We're not going to agree, at least all the time. We're not. Some of us will not agree at any time. We will not agree on anything. Some of us may meet others halfway. Some of us may share the same views in a very, very small way. We may disagree on the majority of things and then agree on some minor things, and vice versa. But to me, it doesn't matter because your thoughts, your perceptions, your ideas, imagination, all of those things that are mental, that take place in the mind, belonging to the human brain, they are ours. They're yours. They're mine. They belong to us. It's really irrelevant what others think about what we think, our thoughts, opinions, what we imagine or visualize. It's really irrelevant. I stay in my lane. So comments by the likes of a Donald Sterling doesn't do anything to Tahuti Ma'atra. They don't do anything in a way that makes me feel frustrated, angry, upset, hurt. No. First of all, that would be too much power if those things, those comments, those words got to me, made me frustrated, angry, mad, sad, what have you. That would be too much power for another individual, another human being to possess over me. That would be too much power. Too much. I'm much too cultivated to fall prey to that. another man's views, opinions, beliefs. See, in my world, another person's perception, views, opinions, beliefs, etc., have no bearing on me. Unless and until I open the door and embrace them, allowing them to have some type of impact upon myself. But I'm much too smart to ever do that. The door is closed and is going to stay closed. So you can say whatever it is that you want to say. In general, or even about me in particular, it will not matter. It has no bearing on me whatsoever. Donald Sterling was raised during a certain time, in a certain place, where white is supreme, superior. Now, it doesn't mean that is true, but in the minds of Donald Sterling and people like him, people of his ilk, it's true. It is their subjective truth. And in some ways, their objective truth, based upon a lot of facts that Donald Sterling shared with us. Now, if you don't know history and you look around, you would think that white folks are superior, superior to the darker peoples on the planet, superior to black people or melanated individuals. It's very understandable how certain people could look around and come to that conclusion based upon modern history, modern accomplishments. As easy to understand. But when you know your history, when you know world history, the history of other people on the planet, it doesn't fly. It doesn't fly. White folks or Europeans may have their high time now, but we've also had our high time. And white folks learned a lot from our people, or the darker people of the planet. I have a serious book collection, a serious library of books and videos, I should say, bearing witness to that last statement. You take the United States of America, for example. It did not just turn to ancient Greece and Rome to build the United States of America, no. It turned to the Moors. It turned to the Native Americans in order to build the United States of America. It wasn't just ancient Rome and ancient Greece. But it was also what the founding fathers, the builders of America, I should say, the builders, because the founding fathers really didn't build America. But the foundation also came from the Moors, the Native Americans, and the people of ancient Kemet. And of course, some other cultures and societies around the world, but most notably, Rome, ancient Rome, ancient Greece, ancient Kemet, the Native Americans, and the Moors. You know, the borrowing. That's what nations do. If you study the history of Hawaii, which was a sovereign nation and also conquered by Europeans. See, a lot of people don't know that. When I first went to Hawaii, I didn't know that. Hawaii was just the 50th state of the United States of America, or the corporate United States, more appropriately. And, well, you know what, let me backtrack, because I did read where the United States hijacked Hawaii at gunpoint. They put a gun to Queen Liliuokalani's head, and I read that in a history book, but I didn't know it was deeper than that. how they annexed Hawaii. That's a deep story. I got the books over there in the collection that I just ordered. It's a deep story. I've done some deep research into Hawaii, which was a sovereign nation that was jacked by Great Britain, but Great Britain gave it back to the Hawaiian people. And I thought about that. I'm like, damn, if somebody can give a nation back, that means they got the power to take the nation. Well, they did take it, but the queen made a British citizen return Hawaii to the rightful owners. And then the United States of America came on the scene in the, I believe it was the late 1800s, or technically the 1700s. That's when they made first contact with Europeans. But the children of the Christian missionaries who went to Hawaii, they were nothing like the citizens of Great Britain, or even the government of Great Britain, because the United States, the white boys from the United States, they didn't care about the Hawaiian people and you know, just being fair and respecting the sovereignty of a sovereign nation. They didn't respect that. They were straight capitalists, you know, straight businessmen. It was straight money, man. That's what it was about. You know, when you study the history, and I know I've deviated, and that's my trademark, y'all know that. But when you study what these white boys, these American white boys did to Hawaii, do you know that white men, white businessmen, the children of Christian missionary, Christianity is always involved, but you know, so-called minorities, people of color, they just can't get it. They just cannot stop swinging on the nutsacks of this man called JC. They just can't. And no matter what Europeans have done to darker people in the name of Christianity, the darker people just can't shake it. I really think about Leonardo DiCaprio's character statement in the movie Django Unchained. You know, there may be that little indentation in the back of the skull of darker people that makes them submissive to white folks. It just very well may be. Because it's 2014 and I'm still trying to figure out how all of these conquered people still embrace the white man's religion. I just don't get it. You even got white folks waking up to the fact that Christianity has done more harm than good and is really not theirs. Because even in their history, paganism outdates or predates Christianity. And so a lot of white folks wake up and they embrace paganism, Wicca. Or they'll embrace Buddhism, you know, they'll embrace Hinduism, you know, they'll embrace something new, hell, even Scientology. But the point is, even enough of them are waking up and looking at Christianity, something that African Americans in particular, but darker peoples around the planet in general, are just having a hard time doing, or maybe they're just slow. I mean, because people are waking up. You know, a lot of black folk, especially here in the headquarters of the Matrix, they are waking up to their history. You know, they really are waking up. Brother Tariq Nasheed is doing a great job with the Hidden Colors series. My man, Coach Cheese, formerly known as Damian McSwan, he's doing some things. So, you know, folks are waking up. You know, you got to give credit to Ashwa Kwesi, Mary Ra Kwesi, Dr. John Henry Clark, Dr. Kaladu Muhammad, Dr. Leonard Jeffries. I mean, you know, it's been going on for a while. We're just slow. We're just really slow, you know, to realizing how Christianity has never really served us. It hasn't. It just really hasn't. And I know a lot of y'all going to take offense at that statement, but unlike many of you, I've done the research. I've done the research with a logical mindset. I come from a perspective of investigation, hermeneutical, exegesis-based investigation. I've watched the videos. I've read the books. There's a lot of good stuff out there, people. But anyway, I've done my homework in that realm, in that arena. And I've come to the conclusion, man, this is a fraud. This has been used to fuck over people for many, many, many years, many, many centuries. And it's still taking place. It serves a purpose. People get life experiences. I mean, I wouldn't be who I am without Christianity. And the effect, the ill effect that it had on my grandmother, who did certain things that I took offense to. Things that repelled me from her, that repelled me from Christianity at a young age. I have digressed within a digression. Damn. But you got to read about what took place with Hawaii. Them white boys, them white businessmen, they jacked Hawaii. They didn't want to pay those high taxes, the tariffs, for exporting and importing sugar, you know, pineapple, and you know, just other products that were coming from Hawaii. Because Hawaii was a nation. It wasn't part of the United States. And so the United States government taxed the white boys in Hawaii who were exporting their goods back to the United States. As a matter of fact, the United States government was making so much money on the taxes from importing Hawaiian goods that the white boys in Hawaii, they were American citizens in Hawaii, they devised a sinister plot. The United States government was making more money from Hawaiian products than the Hawaiian, well, the American businessmen stationed or located in Hawaii. And so much so that it prompted those white boys to create a secret committee. I believe it was called the Committee of Safety. And so you got to look out. You got to look, when you're dealing with Europeans, you're dealing with white folks, you got to look out for safety. Because when white people, those in positions of power, because all white people are not like this, don't think like this, many of them are even quote unquote victims of this thinking from certain members of their own race. But you got to look out for white folks in positions of power and their use of the word safety or public safety. Because when they're going to rob you, steal from you, injure, harm you, it's going to be done in the name of safety. It always has to be justified as something good. Just like enslaving the native people, enslaving the Hawaiians, the Chinese, the Africans, the Native Americans, and on and on and on, pertaining to all the peoples that have been conquered by Europeans, it was always done in the minds of Europeans as something good, something to the benefit, or something for the benefit of these people. They were savages, so we civilized them. We did a good thing. Even though we raped their women and broke up their families, moved them from their lands, or stole their resources, everything that has been done and written in the books, it's all good. It was done for the good of these people. Which really means it was done for the good of those particular white folks. I'm on a roll now. I was watching a documentary, because that's my new school now, documentaries. I've spent a fortune in DVDs. I really feel I have the greatest book collection and also the greatest DVD collection. No BS. I don't watch BS. I watch documentaries, man. The list is so long, it's going to take me some time to write them all down. I've started because I want to share them with you in e-article format at dhealthstore.com. But I was doing some research on Rwanda and that genocide that took place there in 1994. And see, that's some cold stuff. And see, that was black on black violence. People, anytime I talk about things like this, I don't have a horse in any race. Because I'm looking from a panoramic perspective. I study people. And we're pretty much the same. And we've pretty much all experienced the same things. We've pretty much done the same things at some point or another in time. But I was studying investigating the 1994 Rwandan genocide between the Hutus and the Tutsi people. And I mean, this was horrific. I rewatched the movie Hotel Rwanda, and it rekindled an interest into that event. I remember that. I was 24. And so I watched Hotel Rwanda, and then I started watching documentaries. And And you can email me for the names of some of these documentaries on Rwanda. But I watched this one documentary called Ghosts of Rwanda. And it made the movie Hotel Rwanda look like child's play. Black on black violence, man. It was crazy what the Hutus did to the Tutsis. And, you know, when you dig deep like I do, you know, it goes back to the Europeans. The conquest of African lands by Europeans. Because when you dig deep, you find out that you were dealing with Belgium and you were dealing with France. I believe the Tutsis were the agents of those from Belgium, the Belgian colonizers, and the Hutus from the French. It could be the other way around. But anyway, the guns. I was looking at who provided the Africans the guns. And it went back to France. I believe France supplied the weapons for the Hutus. And then also Belgium provided weapons to the Tutsis because, you know, the Tutsis had their rebel army. So both sides had their military, their army. And I'm like, who provided, you know, these Africans who didn't create guns, who provided them the guns? And it went back to Europe. So, and I'm not pointing the finger saying that, you know, the Europeans were responsible for the Rwandan genocide. I just look at the role. I look at the whole picture of a thing. You know, I look at all the parties, all of the agents, you know, to a drama. But, you know, it went back there. You know, the Hutus were mad at the Tutsis for betraying, you know, their native African brethren. They felt that the Tutsi were agents of Belgium and did harm to the Hutus, you know. But anyway, I went back and I revisited the Rwandan genocide a couple of weeks ago. It just really made me think about humanity, and it made me think deep on the impact, the vestiges of European colonialism, and how it's still affecting people centuries later. I have digressed within a digression within a digression. Hawaii. Then let me get back to Donald Sterling. I mean, we're dealing with race, so. But you got to read what happened to Hawaii. That was a cold game. And I recognize the role that Hawaiians played in being conquered by Europeans. Hawaiians developed an admiration of Europeans. Hawaiians let go of their native Hawaiian way of life, their rituals, their religious belief system. They let it go for Christianity. White folks did not put a gun to their head. There was something about Hawaiian leaders and their admiration of the European way. Even adopted a flag that was reflective of Great Britain, the United States, and I believe France. It was three European nations. That's why the Hawaiian flag, the original one, it didn't really reflect a sovereign native tropical people and land. It didn't reflect that. It was too European. And I said the original flag because when they brought down Hawaii, they took the original Hawaiian flag and they cut into little pieces, little 2-inch squares, and passed it out to the rich white folks in Hawaii. Got to read that story there. That's like, man, that was, and that's recent history too, really, because that took place in the 1890s, the late 1800s, around 1893, I believe. You know, the interest in Hawaii was also rekindled because I watched a movie called Princess Kalani. Princess Kualani, yeah, I think it's Princess Kualani. I watched that movie there about the niece of the Queen of Hawaii, and that rekindled the interest, and I started researching, and it's like, man, you know, I knew about the military invasion, but I didn't know that business was the motive. Businessmen use their American influence to take a country from people in order to make profit. Man, that was hellified to me. They took a whole land, and again, the way it was done, the Committee of Safety, and then lying to the United States government saying that there was a threat on American lives and property. You got to look out for that. Oh, I know where I was going. I know why I brought up Rwanda now. I be talking so much. I got that Mars and Gemini. It's so much going on here. I be told what without meditation and chakra balancing. I would really be messed up. There's so much information in here. So much. I'll never run out of videos, ever. Anyway, I know why I brought up Rwanda. Because I was watching a documentary. And this ties into what I'm talking about pertaining to Hawaii, the former sovereign republic of Hawaii. I was watching a documentary on the Rwandan genocide, and you got to study that too, because that too was hellified, man. It was a cold thing that took place, how the United Nations and the European nations didn't get involved, you know. And I really shouldn't say that, because there were 300 members of NATO. And what's his name? General Dallaire. You got to give him props. There were white people involved in Rwanda. You got to give him props. I mean, hell, even the governments, man, of the United States and Great Britain and other European nations don't even give these white people, man, who stayed behind in Rwanda doing the best they could do. They don't even give them credit. See, and people, that's why it's deeper than race. It's not that all white people stick together. Just like it's not about, or it's not like all black people stick together, because we don't. All white people do not stick together, man. Like in this documentary, it boils down to interests. And like Dick Gregory said, it's mindset. That's what really connects people. Let me make this point before I temporarily lose it, or misfile it, if you will. I was watching this documentary on Rwanda. And they brought this one Rwandan female escaped, and she was flown to the United States to Washington, D.C. And she met with a member of President Clinton's cabinet. And his name escapes me right now. But he told this woman who was there to plead for help from the United States, the Clinton administration. She told this aide, this cabinet member, of what was taking place in Rwanda, that it was really bad, it really was bad, and that the United States really should get involved, that they should use their power to stop what was going on in Rwanda, which was really a genocide. And she said something, the black woman, the Rwandan female, the African woman said something that even hit deep within herself, within her own spirit, just like it did to me when I heard it. And after telling this Clinton cabinet member of the United States government about what was really going on in Rwanda, because they tried to downplay it, that was their excuse for not getting involved. But that wasn't the truth of it. The truth of the matter was, and this dude, man, he dropped a nugget, and it resonated. The answer resonated with this woman just like it did with me. And that member of President Clinton's cabinet told this black woman from Rwanda, who had escaped Rwanda and come to the United States of America to plead for help. He told her, the United States has no friends. It only has interest. That blew me away. Like he blew her away. That was a very profound statement. That was a very deep statement. The United States has no friends. It has no friends. Only interests. That means that the United States is only interested in things that benefit the United States. It's not about people. It's not about humanity. Hell, it never was. And it never will be. No matter how many times the puppets change, it'll never be about the people. Ever. You can put a black man in the White House as president, a Latino or Hispanic man, an Asian, it does not matter. As long as they do the bidding of their masters pertaining to their masters' interests, and their masters' interests have been codified as the interests of the United States. And that's how that game is played. And it's a cold game. But that was a hell of a statement. We don't have no friends. We don't care about you people. It's all about interest. And he also said that the United States had no interest in Rwanda. I said, man. Send me an email so I can get you. I have hundreds upon hundreds upon hundreds upon hundreds upon hundreds of DVDs. It's crazy. So you got to send me an email requesting the titles of Hawaiian documentaries or what took place about the illegal annexation of Hawaii, the Rwandan genocide where the statement was made. And what else am I talking about? Well, that's pretty much about it, Rwanda and Hawaii, dealing with European colonialism and that particular mindset of certain white people, of certain Europeans, as it relates to Donald Sterling. I have to slow down here. I was about to say Donald Trump. You know, I'm like, Donald Trump is not as bold as Mr. Donald Sterling. Okay. But anyway, yeah, I know I've digressed, but a lot of y'all have told me y'all like that, you know, so it works out. But okay, anyway, so Hawaii, Rwanda, you study history. Study history, people. History is profound. History gives insight. You know, there's a statement that it's a statement and a maxim, and it states this: those who do not remember the past are condemned to repeat it. And Jim Jones had that inscribed on this this wooden, it was like a wooden piece that hung above the entrance into Jonestown, Guyana. I don't think I've done a video on that, but I need to. Because those people that was not a mass suicide, that was a mass killing. See how I continually deviate and digress? Because I just know so much. And you know, when you know so much, you just have to share, you want to share. It's just so much, you know, because there are people out there right now who think that back in 1978, November 18, 1978, a bunch of people, mostly African-Americans, 90% African-Americans, committed a mass suicide. That's bullshit. They were murdered. They were forced to drink cyanide-laced Kool-Aid at gunpoint. Many of them attempted to escape into the jungles of Guyana, and United States and Great Britain blackwashed troops were flown in to hunt them down and shot those people. Those people were shot in the back of the neck. They were shot in the back, and they were taken back to Jonestown and laid out on the ground with the rest of the people who had died from the cyanide-laced Kool-Aid. It's a cold game. But my man, Jim Keith, I believe it was my man Jim Keith, who did serious research on what really took place in Guyana, as well as Michael Myers, not the Michael Myers of Halloween. He was not a writer. But my man, Michael Myers or Michael Mears, was Jonestown a Massacre. It's a thick white book. And I can send you the title. When I'm making videos, I'm just flowing, you know, but I know there's certain people who are really interested. And they'll send me an email saying to Hootie, hey, what's the actual name? You know, I can't find the name that you gave in the video, but what's the actual name? What's the actual, or who is the actual author, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And they'll go attempt to, you know, locate the material. So the same thing for videos can also be done for books, the appropriate or correct titles, authors, and then also the year the book came out, and then also the publisher as well. So that's all good information to help people locate this information. And I started collecting this information in the late 1990s, and I ended up with a treasure. You know, I know life. I know what took place on this planet, and that's why I'm cool, and that's why I'm successfully navigating. I don't get caught up in the racism, and I don't get caught up in politics. I don't get caught up in religion. I don't get caught up in sexism. I don't get caught up in all of that bullshit that divides people. to the benefit of a select few. I don't get caught up in that. I'm only talking about it for purposes of mentally stimulating you. Period. That's it. That's it. So, yeah, that was a profound statement about the United States having no interest in Rwanda. Because we don't have an interest in Rwanda, we're not coming. We don't care. You know, but they flew out all of the United States citizens. I think there was about 300 or 400 United States citizens in Rwanda, you know, at the beginning of the genocide. You know, later it was dubbed a genocide, you know, but, you know, the Africans knew that, and certain members of NATO knew that it was a genocide from jump, or that a genocide was in effect. But they flew those people out, you know, they flew those people out. So, you know, they knew things were about to get ugly. I mean, why would you remove all United States citizens? But again, when you start dealing with harm coming to American citizens and American property, then the government will act, you know, and in that respect, you got to give them credit. You know, the United States, for the most part, will protect its own. 90-95% of the time, the United States will protect its own. It will protect its property. And United States citizens are the property, the corporate property of the United States government. And they will protect property, even if that property happens to be human beings, because they don't really care about humanity or human beings. But if particular human beings happen to be property of the United States government, like United States citizens, then they will protect that property. And those white boys that hijacked Hawaii, they were U.S. citizens, and in order to get the United States military involved, because, you know, Hawaii, or Hawaii, as some people call it, they did have a police department, and they did have a military. But it was no match for the United States of America. And the white businessmen knew that. So they had to lie and say that American lives and property were at stake, were about to be jeopardized or injured. And that's what brought the United States military on the soil of a sovereign nation. It was all a lie. It was all a lie. But you got to give those white boys credit. I mean, because, man, they orchestrated a smooth coup. It was a serious, smooth coup d'etat that you just got to read about it, man. And I was watching a documentary on YouTube, and, man, these Hawaiian people were just so upset. There was a Senate hearing or a congressional hearing in Hawaii, and the natives of Hawaii, called themselves the Kanaka. They called themselves, I believe, Kanaka Mauli, I believe. That's the term for Native Hawaiians, you know. I believe it's the Kanaka Mauli. Hell, it could be the other way around. But there were members of the Kanaka, and, man, they were, like, upset. But when you study the history of Hawaii, you're like, they have a reason to be upset because their land was stolen. But it was always done. Europeans in positions of power will always make a thing look right and just. You know, as far as the public is concerned, because the king of Hawaii sold land to the American whites. And the Kanaka Mauli, they were pleading with their leaders, King David, do not sell land to the foreigners. Do not sell land to the Europeans. And he did. And he sold a large chunk of Hawaiian land, property, to Europeans. And that gave them the right to protect their property. And the Hawaiian people, think about all of those islands that make up Hawaii. The king only gave the native Hawaiian citizens 1% ownership. So I look at the role that the Hawaiian people, through leadership, that's why leadership government is dangerous, man. I look at the role of the Hawaiian people in that illegal annexing of their land, of Hawaii. They played a role. And it's deeper than that when you go back a few hundred years and research the wars that took place amongst the native Hawaiians and Europeans. Man, Europeans is, man, they're some sharp people. And the Europeans said, hey, you guys want to, you know, bitch and rant about us, you know, taking your country, but you guys did the same thing to your own people centuries ago. See, so they'll study history, and they'll use it to their defense. So they, and when I say they, those Europeans that were defending jacking Hawaii, they threw up Hawaiian history on the Hawaiians. Because the Hawaiian islands were separate territories, and there were wars fought that annexed those islands. However, there was that peace treaty, and that there was that agreement to be a unified collective people, which was a positive thing, but it did come from war, order out of chaos. Planet Earth is a fourth ray zone, according to esoteric astrology. That means harmony out of conflict. And that's why we will always have wars on this planet. I get emails from people who are disillusioned, who don't understand life, and you know, their emails, their inquiries, you know, involve the question, why are there so many wars? Will war ever end? There are a lot of wars on this planet because planet Earth is a fourth ray zone. There's no other planet like it that can come close to it. Not even Mars, not even Vulcan or Vulcan. There are other planets out there that have an influence. The inhabitants of those planets have an influence here on planet Earth. You know, Draconis or Drago. Mars, Draconis, Vulcan, and a few others have influence on this planet. Those who rule and own this planet. This planet is ruled and it is owned. It is a prison planet. And I know that doesn't really sound nice, but I have to keep it real with you. Whew. Damn. Life is really something. But you know what, though? Don't be dismayed. I enjoy it. You know, I may just, you know, sigh of relief or what have you. But I enjoy being here. I enjoy knowing, you know, I enjoy observing. You know, it's certain things that happen on the mundane, you know, they affect you. I'm going to keep it real, but they don't affect me to the point where I get down and give up. Never. Recent research into actress Brittany Murphy from the movie Clueless and 8 Mile. Beautiful Scorpio sister. And what happened to her, what really happened to her and her husband, Simon Monjak. You got to get the DVD, The Terror Within by Julia Davis, former United States government agent who dropped dime on the United States government pertaining to terrorism. And subsequently, or consequently, they began to harass her. I mean, big time. You've never really witnessed anything of this magnitude with one person by the United States government. I mean, the United States government has knocked off a lot of people and have, you know, terrorized and, you know, went after a lot of people. But Julia Davis, man, that was wild. I had never heard of anything like that. You know, I knew about revenge, but to the degree of what Julia Davis and her family experienced, I had never came across information like that. And then you drag innocent actress Brittany Murphy into the picture, and you have a United States government agent who lied and said that Julia Davis was making a film with actress Brittany Murphy, or they were on the set together. And that Brittany Murphy told you that Julia Davis was there, which was a lie, that has Julia Davis going to Brittany Murphy and inquiring. And Brittany was a beautiful soul, a strong soul. And she denied it and put it in writing. And that brought her into the scenario, made her a witness for Julia Davis against the United States government, Homeland Security, and the Immigration Department. So the government turned on Brittany Murphy and Simon Monjak. That's why they died the way they died. Those people were murdered. They poisoned actress Brittany Murphy and her husband, Simon Monjak. They died 5 months apart in the same place, in the same room of the same house, the same exact way. And their deaths were written off as natural causes. Ain't that something? 32 years of age. I forget Simon's age, but both I believe were in their 30s. And it was said that they died of natural causes. Come on, 32 natural causes? Mom, I can't breathe. Abdominal cramps, vomiting. That's not natural causes. Man, that's poisoning. Damn, what does all this have to do with Donald Sterling, huh? Okay. Let's wrap this up here. But see, it all deals with racism, a certain mindset that is prevalent in white folks or Europeans. And Donald Sterling is one of those Caucasians, one of those Europeans that embrace a certain mindset whereby if they feel threatened, or hell, they don't even have to feel threatened, they can just develop an interest in something and they'll move on it. They will murder, they will pillage, they will do a whole bunch of horrible things to quote unquote protect themselves, to protect their interests, or to attain certain interests. And again, people, because I do have a lot of white people, Europeans, who I don't want to say follow me, but you know, who are into me, who listen to me. And it's very important that they, just like all others who listen to me, understand that it is not an indictment against all white people. I'm too smart for that. I know too much history, and I give credit where credit is due. And there have been numerous Caucasians or Europeans who have stood up to tyranny from wherever that tyranny came from, including from their own. And a lot of white people, good white people, have been murdered by corrupt, evil, wicked white folks. Again, protecting their interests. It wasn't a white thing. When a white person murders a white person, it you could say it's white on white violence, but it's not about race. These white people were not killed because they were white. They were killed because they shared a different mindset. They didn't embrace the same interests as those in positions of power. That's why you can take out a Karen Silkwood. You can even take out a President John F. Kennedy and a Senator Bobby Kennedy, despite being the president and being in high political positions or high political office and being Caucasian and even having links to those who have power. But if you betray them, that's all she wrote. You're out. Not because you're white, but because you betrayed interests, which is what John F. Kennedy did. And a lot of Americans don't know that. I mean, Kennedy undergoes an epiphany while in the White House. And that man said, this was 4 or 5 days before he was assassinated, he said that when he left the position of President of the United States, he was going to return the government back to the United States people. That man had discovered some things. That man had actually set out to sign an order to print $4 billion of United States notes. Not Federal Reserve notes, but United States notes. That man, Kennedy, man, he turned into a radical. Because Kennedy was no saint. You know, Kennedy got blood on his hands from the murder of Patrice Lumumba. You know, Kennedy did some things. The Kennedy family, they did some things. Even Papa Kennedy murdered a woman at a movie theater he used to own to silence her. I mean, they're no saints. But I give credit where credit is due. That man attempted to do the right thing after discovering a lot of things that wasn't right about government. And they took that man out in public to set an example to all others. If you get out of line like him, we'll take you out in the public. We don't care if you are Caucasian or white. when you go against us, our dictates pertain to our interests, we will kill you. So, blonde hair and blue eyes is not a shield. It's not a shield that makes you immune to what white folks in positions of power are capable of and also will do to you. Don't get it twisted. Don't. You can go talk to Karen Silkwood. You can go talk to Marilyn Monroe, John Kennedy, Bobby Kennedy. You can go talk to our man, Gary Webb, who dropped dime on the CIA and their involvement in crack cocaine in inner city communities throughout the United States of America. Gary Webb said he shot himself, committed suicide. No, they said he shot himself twice. Shot himself one time, bop, that didn't do it. So he shot himself again, bop, and conveniently put a pillow over his head before he did it. But see, that's government saying, you know what, the American people are so stupid, you can tell them anything. All right. Let's wrap up here on Donald Sterling. So Donald Sterling embraces a mindset that is shared by many in the society. But see, here's where Donald Sterling, I gotta watch out. I don't want to say Donald Trump, you know. Donald Trump is, you know, he's not, well, where Sterling is, but y'all know what I'm attempting to say. Trump is cool. Trump is, he's nowhere near Donald Sterling. Donald Trump is an individual on a certain level. So there are some views that he does share with individuals of a Donald Sterling and his ilk. Let me just say that. But Donald Sterling, not Donald Trump, but Donald Sterling. Donald Sterling let the cat out of the bag. Because there are many others, including owners of NBA teams, who think just like Donald Sterling. But see, Donald Sterling, where he messed up at is he let the cat out of the bag. He exposed himself. And so the other owners and other white folks, especially white males who think like him, they have to sacrifice him. Because even though he's Caucasian and he shares that similar mindset, he threatened their interest. It is a organization, a cabal of rich white males, financially rich white males, but they have an interest. And that interest of those white males, those rich, financially rich white males, happens to be the color green. Money. Dollar bills, that unit of measurement that they use to control the people. Did you know that a dollar is a unit of measurement? It's so much I could share with people, but a dollar. I mean, the American people are working for units of measurements because a dollar is a unit of measurement. And, you know, real payment, you know, real tangible wealth, a substance, if you will, it's gold and silver. And a dollar is a unit of measurement by which you measure gold and or silver. That's why you have a gold dollar, a silver dollar. It's a unit of measurement. But they removed the gold and silver, right? United States, corporate United States went off the gold and silver standard. It was official back in 1968, thanks to Richard Milhouse Nixon. And so they just left the American people with the unit of measurement called the dollar. Man, you owe me some money, man. I don't owe you no money. Yes, you do, man. Man, you owe me $200. Dollars of what? That's like saying somebody owes you you know, a pint, or owe you a quart, owe you a gallon, and all these other measurements. Man, you owe me an inch. You owe me some inches, man. Man, you owe me some quarts. You owe me some pints. Man, you owe me some gallons. Gallons of what, man? Man, you owe me some gallons of beer, man. Gallons of milk, pints of Kool-Aid. We don't attach a substance to the measurement. So the measurement becomes a thing by which it serves as the measurement, right? That's crazy. And we buy it, we embrace it. The unit of measurement becomes the thing for which it is the measure. Only in America, man. Only in America. And we don't question it. We just. Dollars. It's just wow. And it's just paper. It's a unit of measurement, but it's also paper not backed by any substance. The United States government, the IRS in particular, stated that the. I have this in my case law goodies on taxes. And he said that the substance of dollar bills, American money, is in the collective belief that the American people have about dollar bills. That was the foundation. That's the substance behind dollar bills. The collective American belief that it has value. Ain't that something? That's really wild when you think about it. But the government understands the power of the mind, though. You can remove tangible substance and replace it with intangible substance. Because, you know, belief, collective belief is intangible substance. And you can get away with it like they've done. Man, a lot of you may be depressed right about now, but I mean, this stuff is stimulating to me. I can go on and on to the break it down, but I got to end this video because I got to get out of here. I got things to do in addition to what I'm doing now. You know, it's all my work. So Sterling exposed himself and he was sacrificed. He was sacrificed because he made actually valid statements held by his ilk about black people. However, the black folks in the NBA, black men, black males, more appropriately black males, bring those white boys in a lot of money. See, Donald Sterling's value in the Clippers was, I believe, a billion, or it was 2 billion after the sale. But $2 billion is nothing compared to all of the billions that the owners bring in and are sitting on, and also to the billions brought in by the NBA, National Basketball Association, thanks to black males in particular. But black females, they're into it now too. And you're seeing a lot of minorities also getting into basketball. A lot of the European foreigners, they're getting into to basketball now. But it will always be a black sport. Always. And so blacks bring the value to the NBA. So, yes, those white boys who actually share Donald Sterling's views, most of the owners, I don't want to indict all of them, but most of them, or many of them, they share those views. But they're businessmen. And they're going to protect their interests, which is green, profits brought in by black players. And Donald Sterling offended black players and black people. So even though these rich white boys don't give a damn about black folks, and understandably so when you understand their mindset, they had to do what they had to do to protect their money coming in from this ignorant class of people known as African Americans. So they said, Sterling, you're out. You jeopardize the league, man. You jeopardize the money over some cheap mistress, some mentally twisted Latina. And she had her reasons for this. We can't let her off the hook. See, V. Stiviano was one of those females who was upset, who was mad because she could no longer get her way. See, as long as Sterling was buying her luxury cars, condos, clothes, paying her utilities, and giving her money, she was cool with him. He was the sugar daddy. Everything was private. As long as she was getting her way. But when her way was cut off because of Mrs. Sterling, and understandably and rightfully so, when Mrs. Sterling made Donald cut her off, because that's what happened, you know, a lot of the gifts Donald gave to her, the wife was claiming that those things were from community property. Like, yo, I got a stake in this. You just can't be giving my stuff away. And I understand that. You know, it's like, you know, one time my wife gave away a set of angel cards to somebody who I felt was not worthy of the angel cards. I'm like, yo, what the? You just can't be giving my stuff away. I got a stake in this. I got a say in this, you know. Of course, it can't, you know, compare to just a little deck of angel cards. But still, you know, it's Taurus, you know. But anyway, so Mrs. Sterling wanted those gifts back. And Donald had to, because under California law, community property, share property, that those things constituting community property, there has to be that mutual consent to give them away or to sell them or whatever the case may be. It has to be consent. You just, one member just can't do something. Can't do that. California law. So Stiviano was pissed off. Was pissed off. And she released that recording. She denied it in public. She's smart. She's not smart. Her attorney is smart and denied that she released it. Okay, maybe she didn't release it. Maybe she gave it to somebody to release it so that they could say legally she didn't release it. But you know damn well she did, because she recorded it. It was just between her and Sterling. So how could somebody else end up with the recording? Man, that was a ploy. That was a stratagem against Sterling and his wife. Ain't that something? And you know, people are really ungrateful. I mean, because Sterling really had a soft spot in his heart for Stiviano. He had a soft spot, evidently. And the man did a lot for her. But that's people. That one time they don't get their way, they forget about all the other times you did something for them. That's people for you. That's people for you. The one time she didn't get her way, everything that man did don't mean nothing. I'm going to destroy you. You hurt me. I'm going to get you. I'm going to bring you down. You sending me back to where I was before you, which was down. I'm bringing you with me. I'm hurt. I want you to share my pain. That's female thinking right there. I'm hurt. So you're going to be hurt. Because that's what hurt people do. Hurt people hurt people. That's what hurt people do. I'm hurt. So you're going to be hurt. Remember Mike Tyson talking about how he was hurt and he wanted people to feel his hurt? I'm hurt and I want you to feel my hurt. But Tyson, you had some pleasure, you had some joy, and I never saw an interview whereby you said, I want you to share my joy, my pleasure. I want you to feel it. I want you to feel what I feel, you know, when I bust a nut, when I have an orgasm, when I feel good, I want you to feel it. But no, you don't say that. It's only when you're hurt. I'm hurt and I want to just step on your baby's balls and nut sacks and so you can feel the pain that I feel. So you want us to feel your pain, Mike, but not your pleasure, or the opposite of pain. Man, people, I'm telling you, man, that's what I do with my time. I study people. That's what I do. I work with people, so I study people. And people are a trip. You see, so when you have that insight, you know how to deal with people. You know how to deal with people. I mean, people will say anything to get their way. And if you give them their way and a time comes where you no longer give them their way, they are going to turn on you 9 times out of 10, because there's always an exception to the rule. They will turn on you. I mean, y'all could be lovers. You can share bodily fluids, everything. But that day will come, you guys will be enemies. And that's the 7th house of astrology. The 7th house in astrology, Western astrology, is the house of marriage, of partnership, of divorce. 7th house. The 7th house shares marriage, it also shares divorce. Open enemies. Aren't some married couples open enemies? Like the former owners of the Los Angeles Dodgers, they were married and then they became open enemies. Remember Alec Baldwin and Kim Basinger? They were married, lovers, and then they became open enemies. So man, when you really understand astrology and apply astrology to everything, you got some serious insight. You got some serious insight into the nature of things. So Stiviano was upset and her moves were calculated. They were political. And she succeeded. She succeeded. I just laughed at the scenario, you know. Donald goes down in history as being played by a street-savvy Latina who's confused as well, too. You know, yeah, but I'm not mad at her, though. You know, I understand that mindset. You know, Sterling is racist, but you let him fuck. You let him, you know, inject his energy into you. I heard reports that they didn't have sex. Well, hell, even if the man kissed you, you know, hugged you, embraced you, y'all were intimate. You were intimate with a man who has no love for your people, especially the males of your people. And see, that says a lot about her. That's that prostitute mentality. You may not love my people, but you're paying me. And even if sex wasn't involved, the premise still applies. Because there are a lot of women out there. You have a lot of quote-unquote minority women sleeping with white racists. And know that the man is a racist, but they're getting paid. They're getting paid. That's that prostitute mentality. It doesn't care about the John or the trick. Give me the money. And I'll even embrace the energy. I'll let racist semen enter into my body. Or if he's wearing a condom, I'll let racist energy enter into my body. I mean, something's being entered, whether it's physical or non-physical. You're still playing yourself. All over this illusion, all over this unit of measurement, the dollar. It's wild. It's crazy. So, a lot came out of that case. A lot. I think a lot of people missed the whole picture. They just focus in on those comments that Sterling made about Magic Johnson and blacks. But we also had a situation whereby a woman became vindictive and brought a man down. That vindictive nature brought a man down, a man that cared for her, that took care of her. So we also, well, we not only had racism exposed, but vindictiveness was exposed. Selfishness, unskillful selfishness was exposed. Prostitution, the prostitute mentality was exposed. Betrayal was exposed. A lot of things were exposed in this case. But people, especially African-Americans, they focus in on the comments. And see, they still can't get it that if you want white people to respect you, you got to first respect yourself. So you got a double standard. And see, that's not really right with white folks. White people are illogical. They are a naturally rational, logical people. So the double standard doesn't make any sense to them. You call yourself nigga daily. Then they call you nigger, and we know nigger came from nigger. Hey, you Tupac, you my boy, and I know you tried to switch some things up, and Nas, you tried to do some things too, but no. Nigger came from nigger, because black people, we speak differently than white folks. We more of a type of people. We are A people, A-H people. So E-R becomes ah, to us. So nigger become nigger. What up, my nigga? And we accept that. Because in our minds, we have differentiated nigga from nigger. So, a white boy who tries to be hip, hell, he may even be hip. But if not, if he's trying to be hip, he can come along and say, yo, what up, my nigga? Yo, nigga, what's up, motherfucker? Nigga Eminem, what's nigga, my nigga? But if that same white boy came on the scene and said, what up, my nigger? You're like, oh, what? Nigger? Shit. You know, slavery, images of slavery, you know, the psychological damage, the trauma from slavery comes out. Like, nigger, that shit. You know, we start seeing images of hung black men and castrated black men and raped black women. And, you know, we're still traumatized by that because we haven't dealt with it. We don't want to deal with it. We want to sweep it under the rug. And we want to sing We All the World. And you know, can't we all get along? And why can't we be friends? We don't want to deal with it. It's too painful. It's painful for white folks, and it's painful for black folks. It's painful. So we just pretend. So we don't want to deal with that. We just jump over certain things, and we'll get together, and there's a lot of sex going on. There's a lot of black men fucking white females making up for what took place in slavery with white men fucking black females. Like my Uncle Sam the Bama Cunningham always told me, he said, the black woman and the white man have always been free to fuck. The problem has been with black men and white women. A lot of damage has come from that. A lot of white women have been murdered due to fucking black men. And we know a whole bunch of black men been murdered by white men for fucking white women. And I know in some cases there was some love making. It does matter. Black penis, white vagina, no. Die for that. Male and female. White woman, you die. Black man, you die. It's like in the movie Mandingo. Mandingo. Mandingo had sex with his master's wife. That she initiated. She initiated the affair. And got knocked up, got pregnant. Knocked up is a term that came out of slavery, by the way. And white dude murdered her. Gave her some poison. Because, see, that's it's psychologically damaging to white males in general, that is. To a lot of white males in general, that's psychologically damaging. To hell with love, to help the white woman, she has no say. So they'll kill her before they kill the black man that had sex with her. And to impregnate, that's just a little bit too much. So in Mandingo, hell, the master was not just going to kill him, not just hang him. He was going to boil him to death. I said, God damn, that's, ooh. You know, shit, just shoot him or just hang him. No, the master made Ken Norton's character Mandingo set a big fire like a bowl of soup, boiling water for him to get into. I'm not just going to kill you. You going to suffer. It's deep. It's deep. But, you know, generally speaking, we don't like to deal with it. It's too painful. So we make jokes. You know, racist jokes, you know. And you have that double standard. You know, you take my man Paul Mooney. Just like Richard Pryor. And they used the word nigga and, you know, talked about race and, you know, the two races, especially Richard Pryor. well, back in the Richard Pryor was more out there, more known than Paul Mooney. But if you listen to Paul Mooney was more hardcore than Richard Pryor, especially about, you know, the N-word, you know, saying nigga, and dealing with race relations, you know. And Mooney, I mean, just no mercy on white folks. Mooney makes white people leave the audience. Richard Pryor didn't do that. But anyway, the point is, there's that double standard. You see, you have Paul Mooney, and he gets to say nigga, 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 nigga. Just like the rapper, they can say nigga, 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 nigga. White folks, white comedians, can say nigger, and black folks up in arms. And white folks like, but you say it. You say, they don't say nigga, nigger. They just, well, black people pronunciate things different. You know, if you study the video, The Story of English, it breaks down the English language and how we have like certain dialects, the Gullah language, you know, and while we have, you know, our vernacular, the black vernacular, there's a book called From Juba to Jive. It's a great book, and it deals with, you know, our dialect of English, if you will. And you know, it pretty much explains Ebonics, or where Ebonics came from, why we speak the way we speak. And that's because of that Gullah influence, you know, and other cultural influences on the language. And so that's why we do have a black vernacular, you know, and they have books written on the black vernacular. Jive, turkey, jive, you know, that's black vernacular, jive. Can you dig it? You know, that's black vernacular. Babe, we gonna boogie. That's an outdated term, but that's black vernacular. You see, it does exist, and you need to study it. It's good stuff to study, too, by the way. Sharpens the mind. I love etymology. And the etymology of certain terms, you know, comes to the black vernacular, very interesting. Very interesting, by the way. Donald Sterling, man. Let the cat out of the bag. Lost his team. And I would be remiss if I closed out the video without talking about the comments of certain African American. You take Magic Johnson. And I like Magic. Magic is my all-time favorite NBA player. I like Magic Johnson. But Magic, he has that mentality. See, he got the white man's mentality still. All we can do is just pray for Donald. Yeah, prayer don't work. Like in the movie Sankofa, when the slave master bent her over and was tagging her doggy style. She's like, I'm praying, but praying ain't working. White master was just tagging, just hitting her. She didn't want it, but she was taught to pray. But Jesus just, you know, Jesus AWOL. Jesus don't answer. Hell, Jesus, it's 2014. Jesus is not answering folks. And he's still in the Jesus. Man. Hey, you know, the world is the way it's supposed to be, man. You know, people, man, it's a collective agreement. The world is the way it's supposed to be. All we can do is just pray for him. Like, prayer is going to change this man. That man is rooted here. Those racist views are rooted here. You can't pray that out of a person. Mm-mm. Hell, it was racist white men who taught you how to pray anyway. Like my brother Dr. Sabi says, before the white man came on the scene, that black woman in Africa didn't have to pray because she was living righteous. White folks taught you about original sin. And the beautiful brother, Reverend Ike, came along, taught metaphysics under Christianity, and drop something heavy on us that we still don't get. And that's all Christians, whether you black, white, or whatever else. Reverend Ike challenged the concept of original sin. You were born in sin, so you need to give your life to Christ, or really the church. Reverend Ike was like, original sin? He debunked it. I was not born in original sin. Because I was made in the image and likeness of God. So how in the hell can you be born in sin at the same time being made or created in the image of God unless God is sin? I don't want to get too religious on you. Because black people, you know, there's a switch. It activates, you know. It's just like Leonardo DiCaprio's character in Django said. It's something, it's a switch in us. And a lot of people attribute it to the Anunnaki and, you know, the alien gods. Whatever the source, from what I see is true. There's a switch. There's a God switch in black folks. And white folks, those in positions of power, they have learned it and mastered it. They have learned it and mastered it. Like the saying, the white man came along, he had the Bible. The black man, Native American, whoever else, they had the land. And the white man taught them how to pray. Close your eyes and let's pray. And when they opened their eyes, being through with praying, the white man had the land and the natives, the original people, had the Bible. And it's still like that. He got your land and you got his book and his religion. And then you come to me talking about your life is messed up. You don't understand life. You can't seem to get ahead. You're spiritually deflated. Life has no meaning. You got a lot of homework to do. Now, I know these words are very controversial, but it's real. It's real. And it affects everyone. It affects us all. White folks are affected by the legacy of slavery. You got certain white people who beat themselves up. And they didn't own an African or Africans. Maybe their grandparents or great-grandparents. But, you know, their argument, which I understand, is I didn't enslave black people. I didn't do it. But black folks are over here saying, well, yeah, you didn't own us, but you benefit from those who did own us. You ain't gave up your legacy. Your people got rich off of slavery. And now you're rich. They passed it down to you and you accepted it. You know, you didn't do like John Robbins of Baskin Robbins and give the family fortune away. And there are white people out there, you know, who come into consciousness and say, hey, man, my family got this money from blood, you know, from unrighteous activity. I don't want nothing to do with this. And they go out and do their own thing. And John Robbins is one of those individuals. I give him credit. I give him credit. You know, there are people out there, you know, with integrity that a lot of us just don't know about. We get so caught up in the whole race. All blacks are like this. All whites are like that. And we just do a disservice. We just do a disservice to the whole scheme of things. We got to come up. See, when you come up, you get to look at things. I knew as a little boy that I wanted to be global. And I had no idea how I was going to burst through that wall of racism that I learned about as a little boy. And I didn't know how I would do it, but I knew I would be global. I knew I would overcome it. I didn't know how, but I just knew I would. And that's where I'm at today. And it really feels good being free to travel anywhere I want to be embraced by people all over the planet. Asians, Caucasians, Africans, and Native Americans, and Hawaiians, and, you know, it's just a beautiful feeling because, but see, for a person like myself, I see beneath the flesh. See, we're all people. We got different languages, and, you know, we even have, you know, differences, external differences, you know, hair texture and color and eyes and all of that. But see, underneath, I see underneath all of that. And it's like, you know, we really are one people. We have to be, because we're on one planet, breathing one oxygen, eating one planetary vegetation. We have to be. I mean, we have our conflicts and our wars, what have you. But when you cultivate spiritually, you get above all of that. Because that takes place even within cultures and races. Black on black. Fighting, violence, what have you. White on white. Asian on Asian. Like my man Dick Gregory said, blacks are the largest killers of black because you kill where you're at. white people are the biggest killers of white people because you kill where you're at. Asians are the biggest killers of Asians because you kill where you're at. And I'm talking about killing pertaining to, you know, human beings killing one another. And we are a very strange species because we're the only species that kill itself or fellow members of the tribe, of the species. Humans. Lions don't kill lions. Tigers don't kill tigers. Now, there is an exception to the rule pertaining to diet. And you see that with snakes because, you know, there are snakes out there that kill and eat other snakes. But it's diet. It's for food. Like, if they're not hungry, then they don't kill. But see, human beings, we'll kill and it ain't got nothing to do with diet. See, that's the exception there. Even when animals kill animals that's not in their tribe, you know, like a lion killing a zebra, it only does that for survival purposes to eat. And see, once a lion kills a zebra and eats that zebra and it's full, it will not kill another zebra or any other animal until it's hungry. And I can deal with that because it respects the law of balance. There's a natural law of balance. It doesn't taint the balance. Lions will never jeopardize zebras, putting zebras into extinction. You know, lions won't do that. Tigers won't do that. They will kill and eat, but in their killing and eating, which is their nature, by the way, so that means they're in tune with nature, they won't cause an imbalance in nature like man does. And I know my Afrocentric brothers and sisters who are watching this will point the finger and say, well, that's the white man who does that. But see, that's, you know, that's passing the buck. White people may lead and they may do it more, but we're involved because we do kill. We do kill. Now, one thing I can say about Native people, like the Native Americans and Africans, they never killed and used more than they needed. See, that's the difference with white folks. So when you look at, you know, McDonald's and Burger King, the meat industry, the dairy industry, what have you, more than is needed is being killed, being harmed. It's not even about survival. It's about profit. It's about profit. See, and that takes you into that European capitalist mindset, which really needs to be studied, because that mindset that can be embraced by any human being, it will do harm for the sake of profit. And that's pathology. That's pathology. And there are more Europeans, especially European males, who lead in that as compared to Asians and Africans and others, because they do it too, just not to the degree of Europeans. And that's why you have a lot of quote-unquote so-called minorities who will point the finger and say the white man is messing up the world because he leads in doing destructive things. And these same people who point the finger, they will never point the finger at themselves and see how they are abating and aiding that white man who is harming the planet or doing all of this harm to animals, to the planet, to humanity, etc., to women. They don't see the role they play. You know, you could talk about King Leopold and chopping off hands of African people so that he could get a market on rubber. You know, so, you know, you got Afrocentrics talking about King Leopold and chopping off the hands of Africans, chopping off ankles, chopping off the feet of Africans, exploiting these people, their services, on top of the resources, but their services in producing rubber. So they'll give a one-hour lecture on King Leopold and the Congo and what took place, you know, with the Congolese people. And leave that lecture and get into a car to go home or go get something to eat. Never paying attention to the fact that that car that they're driving has four wheels. And those wheels have tires made of rubber. So you got to see the whole picture. And when you see the whole picture, you be like, yo, let me sit back and chill. Because directly or indirectly, I'm aiding and abetting. When I buy a car, I'm buying tires. I'm putting money in the pocket of the rubber industry. that has a history of harming African people. I'm playing a role. Because let's keep it real, I don't have to have a car. You don't have to have a car. See, we make excuses. We come up with a justification. Well, I got to get to work. I got to go pick my children up. That's aiding and abetting. Corporations are messing up the planet. All of us, all races, all cultures, all genders, young and old, we play a role. You see soda cans in the ocean and shampoo bottles in the ocean and burger wrappers in the ocean. Man, that came from people, man, who bought that stuff. And the corporation didn't throw the stuff into the ocean. They do it a different type of way through oil spills and, you know, other ways. But the masses of the people are the ones who do great harm in individual capacity. Talking about the corporations are messing up the planet. The corporation couldn't survive. It couldn't exist if you didn't finance it. But see, you're so dependent on the goddamn corporation that the corporation got power because you a slave. You can't talk about Starbucks and Coca-Cola and Pepsi and Bayer and Pfizer. Department store industry, the fashion industry, the automotive or automobile industry. You can't talk about any of these industries, man, because you're dependent upon those industries and corporations know it. And that's why when people try to boycott the airlines, dealing with the airline industry, we're going to boycott the airlines because they're raising prices and charging extra gas prices and they do all type of stuff. I think a couple of years ago, the boycott against airlines was supposed to be against TSA. And then also spiked airline prices. Doesn't work. Same thing with the attempts to not purchase gas. Doesn't work. Too many people are dependent upon gas to get to work because they're slaves, man. If they don't get to work or if they get fired from work, then their life is over because the job is the umbilical cord. That's how they breathe, man. That's how they live. So if they lose their job, then they're out because they don't provide for self, and most don't know how to provide for self. That's why we have more workers, more employees than we do employers or entrepreneurs. And that, too, is by design. Mostly indirect design, but it is by design. So the people can't fight corporations because the people are dependent upon corporations. The people are dependent upon corporations for livelihood. You got people who work for the tobacco industry. I got documentaries where people work for the tobacco industry and they're interviewed justifying the tobacco industry all because of a job. They don't care that people die from smoking cigarettes that contain carcinogenic tobacco. Now, tobacco in and of itself is not carcinogenic. But the one man is responsible for, the one that man had put his corrupted hands on, will kill you. Tobacco was a sacred plant of the Native Americans. They didn't inhale. They would blow the smoke out in your face, and it would enhance your aura. See? But Europeans, through the corporations, added in toxins. Today, you have over 700 toxins that when you light fire to a cigarette, convert those 700 toxins into 1,400 toxins, man. For profit. To control people. It's a legal drug. And all Western nations have legal drugs to control the masses of their people. All of their people, if you're a citizen and you're in Denmark and you're in Switzerland and you're in Great Britain, if you're in the United States, if you're in Canada, they got legal drugs for you. Sugar, salt, caffeine, nicotine. And you're seeing all these people now with the electronic cigarettes doing a disgrace to the environment. Like that's better for the environment. People are part of the environment. You are one with the environment, man. So now they got you sucking on a metallic dick, an e-cigarette. Because E now stands for ecology, environment. Everything is E, eco. Now they gonna come up with a goddamn eco cigarette, man. Psst. See, it's that mentality that, it's that profit-driven mentality. People are hooked on nicotine. So we want to stop doing severe damage to the earth, right? And be a little bit more responsible. So instead of having, you know, the old-fashioned cigarettes, we're going to come up with an eco-friendly cigarette. Because after all, and at the end of the day, the junkies, the nicotine junkies, got to get their nicotine fit. They got to get, I'm not fit, but fix. You know, they're fiends, they're nicotine fiends, and a fiend has to get his daily, his or her daily fix. So we're going to replace the paper cigarette, which is a conveyor of nicotine, as Russell Crowe's character in the movie The Insider said, that a cigarette is nothing but a conveyor for nicotine. Go watch that movie with Al Pacino and Russell Crowe. The Insider. I think it came out in 96, if I'm not mistaken. Great movie, man. But listen to Russell Crowe's character. Cigarettes are a conveyor for nicotine. People are purchasing and smoking cigarettes for nicotine, man. They're getting their nicotine fix to prevent from having a nicotine fit, as my mother used to say, and she smoked. And she's not here today because of cancer. And the smoking played a role. So now they got an electronic or metallic cigarette, which are dangerous, man, because the levels of nicotine that enters the body from these new e-cigarettes is worse than the paper cigarette. And people are already dying from nicotine poisoning. It's a cold game. And that's why I said you have to watch certain individuals, government, public safety. Ain't that a bitch? We lost the right to travel under so-called public safety when former California Governor Gray Davis tripled DMV registration fees. I read it in the LA Times where he justified it under public safety. And you got to understand that, people. This goes for you too, white people. Because it is white people in positions of power who will always move on you, on the people, through safety. All of the civil rights we have lost was over safety, protecting us against terrorism. And Americans, we are known, U.S. citizens, I should say. Let me be correct here. U.S. citizens, corporate property of Congress of the United States government. You know, we will give up liberty. We will give up freedom over safety. And it doesn't matter that you had white people like some of the founding fathers like Thomas Jefferson who brilliantly said, the people who would give up liberty or freedom for security deserves neither. And that makes sense to me. I concur with Thomas Jefferson on that statement. On that statement. Because I know the history of Thomas Jefferson. But I concur with that statement. How are you going to give up freedom for protection or freedom for safety, man? Please. You falling for that okie doke? The government is supposed to respect your freedom and also protect you and protect your freedom. But they didn't dumb you down so effectively that they can tell you now that you gotta choose between two rights, two protected rights. You can't have both now. You can't be free and protected. You gotta give up one for the other. Now, if y'all want us to protect y'all gotta give up some of your freedom so that we can protect you. That's stupid, man. It's absurd. We got to get rid of three amendments of the Bill of Rights in order to enforce seven of them. Or you got to lose four in order for us to grant you the sixth that's remaining of the Bill of Rights. That's crazy. I'm not saying that has happened, but it follows the same logic. Give up the Ninth Amendment so that, you know, we can uphold the Second Amendment or the Fourth Amendment. They don't uphold the Second Amendment. They working on that big time. I got some documentaries on Second Amendment rights. I thought them white boys in them rifle clubs was just kind of like, you know, just kind of on a rocker there. But no, they know something. Need them guns, man, for government. See, you got to go back and study constitutional history. Constitutional law history, man. Then all this stuff started making sense. Like them white boys, them gun clubs, they're not crazy. They are protecting the last vestiges of freedom, of constitutionally secured rights because they've been jeopardized. Free speech been jeopardized. You know, Fourth Amendment, the right to be secure in your person, is jeopardized. Dude, who need my job till I gotta get vaccinated? That's a violation of the Fourth Amendment. You have the right to be secure in your person. And that's enforced against government. Now, do you understand why we have all of the junk food restaurants and all of the legal drugs and all of the porn and all of the crazy music? Do you understand why we have it, man? It's easier for them to control us. It's easier for them to control us and controlling us with isms. Terrorism. Just like they had socialism. Bolshevikism, Nazism, and the latest ism is terrorism, isms and schisms. Bob Marley warned you about the isms and schisms. That's why they took Bob Marley out, the CIA, the Bush-led CIA. And this is in the books. I get emails. People hit me up on social media. Where'd you get this from? Where'd you get that from? Like I sit here and make this shit up. Man, I study, man. I'm not like the masses of the people on social media wasting valuable time. Time is something you can't get back, man. Time is valuable. Here your ass is broken, struggling, and you wasting your time on social media, not making money, not generating income while on social media. Stupid. Caught up in all type of bullshit and all these crazy TV shows and seduction and Atlanta house sluts and all this crazy stuff that's not feeding you here. Falling prey to the isms and schisms of the imps, of the rulers. You caught up on racism. Donald Sterling. Paul Mooney. Richard Pryor, and all these other people out here who are using certain words that they emotionally charge. They hit buttons in people walking out of comedy clubs. Falling prey to racism. The bell curve in books. Whites are smarter than blacks, and blacks are smarter than whites, and blacks are the gods and superior, and white folks are devils and inferior. All this craziness, man. It's crazy shit, man, and it does not serve you, and it does not serve humanity, and it does not serve this damn planet, man. Division. Divide and conquer. Racism, it divides and it conquers people, man. Genderism. Men are superior to women, or women are superior to men. That's division. That shit don't serve nobody. Ageism, discriminating against the old and the young. Classism, all these goddamn isms, man. Bob Marley warned us about the isms and the schisms. But no, we just gotta have our Starbucks coffee. You know, we just gotta have our McDookie burger. You know, we got to have our caffeine. You know, we just got to suck that electronic dick now, the e-cigarette. We just got to do that. Or we got to twerk, you know. We got to go get our hair done. We got to get a hair hat. You know, we got to do this shit here. You know, we got to tune into seduction. You know, we got to watch the Super Bowl. Donald Sterling racist comments. Just like Barack Obama being inaugurated as president. I didn't care about it because it has no bearing on me. It has no bearing on Tahuti Ma'ara. I don't give a damn who the president is. White man or black man, I don't give a damn. They're all the same. Barack is no different from Bush or Clinton or Reagan. And when you get a Latino or a Hispanic president, it's going to be the same thing. Same thing. It's all a game, man. It's all a game, and you're here to learn that game, and you are here to play that game, but you're here to play that game to win at that game, so that you can walk away from that game and do your thing, because you're citizens of two worlds at the same time, material citizens and spiritual citizens. Or you're doing a material thing, but to the neglect of the spiritual side of yourself. You're not a good spiritual citizen. You pay all your taxes, you kiss the ass of government, you do all of that stuff there on the material side, but you don't do it on the spiritual side. And there's no ass kissing on the spiritual side. Hell, the spiritual side will even have you set up to successfully live on the material side. That's the whole key to successful living in the material world, in the mundane world. The spiritual citizenship, successful spiritual citizenship, will set you up for a successful material citizenship. I'm not this fortunate, lucky goddamn person that God said, I have favor on you, Tahuti. No! I understand, man. I understand. I overstand. This setup, the scheme of things. So I live successfully in the mundane world. I know how to handle things. I'm a business owner. I get letters from the government, IRS, the state. I handle. I don't run. I handle. I'm playing the game. I have answers to the problems that are part of the game. The problems are part of the game, people. But in order to successfully navigate, you got to get in tune with your higher self, the spiritual self. You got to. Can't get caught up on comments of a Donald Sterling. Those are his views. And his views are not your views, or they don't have to be your views. You think it bothers me if a white man says that black people are inferior? No, because I know me. And even if it is applicable to others of my race, it does not apply to me. It does not apply to me. I meet white men all the time, and they focus on the fact that I'm 6'3". And so 9 times out of 10, did you play basketball? Are you a basketball player? I don't get offended because that's what they see. They watch black culture. They know. Just like the white owners of the NBA, it's geared towards African Americans. We're the ones buying the hats and the jackets and the jerseys and the shoes. No matter how broke we complain about being, we buy that shit that we don't need because that's the type of people we are. And white folks, those in positions of power, those who run the NBA, they know that. They study that. They know us. We into Grant Hill. We into Kevin Durant. We into LeBron James. So the white man said, hell, instead of doing for all of them, hell, we just get one. LeBron James, Michael Jordan, Magic Johnson. We give him $5 million, $10 million, $20 million. And he'll go get the rest. He'll get all the women and get all the males. That's how they do it. Because it's cheaper paying Michael Jordan or Kobe Bryant $20 million than paying African Americans $200 million or $2 billion, whatever it may be. We don't have to waste a lot of money on getting all of them. All we got to do is just get one and let that one get the masses of them. We're simpletons, man. And a lot of us, you know, Donald Sterling's racist comments, man, really bothered a lot of us because for a lot of us on a deep psychological level, we know sports is reflective of slavery, especially basketball, especially the NBA with the white coach. Even though that's changing though, but still, when you see an NBA coach, you see a white man or you think of a white man. And when you look at the player, the slave, the Bucks running up and down the court, they're blacks. They're blacks doing all the hard work. Like there's a book I call $40 Million Slaves. It's so true. They're slaves. They're paid today. They get to fuck their master's daughter today. But they're still slaves, man. They're still slaves. You can just look at their communities whereby they come from. They don't go back and fix up the community. And some of them got good reason for that, you know, because a few in the NBA have tried to go back home and do things for the community while blacks were in a certain state and ended up with nothing. And ended up with nothing. And I remember the good brother Louis Farrakhan said years ago, you cannot build up communities without first building up people. Because if you build up communities and you don't build up people, people will destroy those communities that you build. Or if you erect buildings before you erect people, people will destroy those damn buildings. You invest in people. And when you look at the United States government, when you look at corporations, they don't invest in people. They invest in things. And that's why people become dependent upon things, and then people also destroy those things, especially when they're pissed off, like during riots. And there is the exception to the rule of when a professional sports team win a championship. That's mostly with white folks, you know. I had a friend, she was Caucasian, named Jeannie. And one day she heard me just being real hard on black people and riots and how black people would tear down their own communities. And Jeannie brought to my attention, she was like, well, what about white people? When white people riot over soccer games and, you know, and sports championships. This was back in the 90s. And I was like, she got a good point there. You know, I don't know which one is worse, you know, but it's just stupid. Whether a team win or, you know, there's a verdict that comes out that you don't like, you know, cops let off the hook for beating a black person or so-called minority, and you riot, it just, you know, both scenarios to me don't make any sense. I mean, what are you accomplishing? You know, especially when you are dependent upon your community. You know, I can see if you're going to go to, you know, a different community whereby the people who you feel violated you or got off the hook, I can see if you go to their community. I could see if, you know, the 1992 riots took place in Silicon Valley. Not Silicon Valley, but a semi-valley. Excuse me. Semi-valley. That's where the Rodney King trial was moved to. So I could see if blacks went to semi-valley and rioted. But no, they didn't go to semi-valley. They did it in Compton, Long Beach, Watts, South Central Los Angeles, Hollywood. That was a riot that actually went outside of the black community. But, you know, the bulk of it was South Central Los Angeles. We destroyed our own community and begged the government that we have issues with to rebuild. I mean, it's really crazy, man. I can go on and on to the break of dawn about it. I mean, it's really crazy. And like I said in a previous video, recently uploaded here, dhealthstore.com. Black people, African Americans, have been here too goddamn long to not know the game, man. To not know and to not look out for the booby traps and the snares and the pitfall set up for them. Make too many goddamn excuses, man. You've been here too goddamn long. You've been here longer than the Irish, the Jews, the Italians, the Russians, the Chinese. You've been here too long, man. Black people ought to know this system. We ought to know white folks better than anybody else, including white folks. But we don't. But we don't. We just point the finger. How the hell are you going to point the finger in the age of the internet, man? It's easy to research now. But it's that lazy ass gene in us. Self-entitlement. Our ancestors worked for us, so I ain't got to work. The hell you don't. There's plenty of white folk who don't give a damn about that scenario. Because they see themselves having to work. Because if they don't work, their asses are assed out. Go check out Inside Man and check out the videos in my collection about that 2008 burst. I'm talking about the real estate, you know, the home market burst of 2008. Scenario shown in Capitalism, A Love Affair by Michael Moore. Inside Job, which is a great documentary. Fuck white folks up. Government didn't give a damn. Because we all one now. We all the same. We all got civil rights now. We all U.S. citizens. We all colored people now. It started with black folks. It just started with us. But it hit all other people. So today we all U.S. citizens. That means that we all get equally fucked. To them, a rectum is a rectum is a rectum is a rectum. A white rectum is still a rectum. A black rectum is still a rectum. A yellow rectum is still a rectum. A red rectum is still a rectum. They don't give a damn. They focus on rectums. Ramming them. That's what time it is. So I could go on and on, but I got to get out of here, people. On behalf of DHealthStore.com, the only business that's really going to bring this type of information to you, because hell, it ain't about profit. You know, I probably pissed a lot of people off, black and white, with this video. So it ain't about profits. It's about the people. Peace and love.